Hey guys, thanks for joining us on another interactive devotion. It's a simple, small devotional snippet that will blow your mind away, but even much more so, that will bring God closer to you. I must say, will bring you closer to God, because God is closer to you than you think. The title for today is Sanctified Lips. And speaking about lips, I realize my lips are not very good. And today we'll be talking exactly about that. Sanctified lips. We are in Isaiah chapter 6. The book of Isaiah is amazing. Read the book of Isaiah. My favorite is Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18. There it says, though your sins be red as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. The promise of forgiveness and transformation is embedded in the book of Isaiah. Throughout the entire book of Isaiah, there's the theme of redemption, salvation, and the greatness of the mercies of God. So we are in Isaiah chapter 6, and the verse of concentration really is verse number 7, but we need some backdrop so we know exactly what's going on. So go with me from verse number 1. There it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Interesting thoughts here. This verse is loaded. It says that in the year that King Uzziah died, that's when Isaiah sees the Lord. It's very significant to take notice of this phrase, the year that King Uzziah died. Who is King Uzziah? Evidently, King Uzziah was a king, a very prominent person, a very important person, one who was regarded as an honest man. In fact, when you read about the story of Uzziah, Uzziah was a man of God for the first part of his life, but the latter part of his life, he died in a terrible death. Uzziah did something that was not permitted by God. He went into the temple and did sacrifice when he was not permitted to do so, and God struck him with leprosy, and that's how this great man of God dies. And so in this time frame, you can imagine Isaiah being perplexed by these questions. Now there's no king, now there's no future, now there's no hope, but yet God is present. And that's why God gives him this vision, to assure him that he is still present. Maybe today, in the midst of death, in the midst of depression, in the midst of doubt, in the midst of darkness, depravity, is God there? We ask. Is God present? We ask. And the answer is found in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne. God is saying, I am sitting on the throne. God is saying, I am in control. In his calm eternity, God controls the affairs of the universe. He notices the tears on our eyes. He notices our anxieties, our trials and temptations. In fact, in all cases, he weighs them and only allows that which we can endure. And so God is present in the midst. How do we put this? God is present in the absence of peace sometimes. God is present when we think he is not there. And then Isaiah sees something else. He sees seraphims. Each one had six wings, with two covering the face, with two covering the feet, and with two flying. That's interesting. So you have these six wings showing great reverence. Angels don't look at God directly. They veil their faces. They veil their feet, and with two they do fly. And notice what they do next. Verse number 3, and one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Holy, holy, holy. That famous song, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty. I can't sing, but you know where this is going. Reverence. Reverence before God. And it is this reverence that now fills the temple with some movement. Verse 4 says, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Praise has power to break bones. Praise has power to free us. Remember when Paul and Silas praised God in prison, God opened. The prison doors were broken up, and the same can happen in our lives when we submit to God. The only thing that's left is for the devil to flee, because he has nothing to do with God. So submit therefore yourselves to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Verse number 5 now, Isaiah responds to this vision. He's like, okay, God, you've showed me whatever you want to show me. Now here's my reaction. Verse number 5, then said I, war is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Isaiah's like, no way, I'm done. I've seen God. The reverence that Isaiah saw really impressed upon his mind that, yeah, he doesn't belong here. And if we picture the scenery of what's going on, we can also say that we are undone. We are a people of unclean lips. We do not deserve the grace of God. We do not deserve to see God. We do not deserve to have a high priest, Jesus Christ, interceding for us every day. And perhaps you feel the same. And since we are here, let's clarify the issue of lips, right? Because we started with that in the introduction, lips. Jesus Christ taught us that outside of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And this is found in Matthew chapter 12. Jesus tells the disciples that the words are the index of the heart, right? So things that you say in your mouth represent what is in your heart. And so let us understand that lips is not meaning that the lips are cracked or they have no lipstick, whatever you want to call it. It simply means that the condition of the heart is disturbed. The condition of the heart is not perfect as God would have it to be. So what is the solution now? Verse number 6, then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his heart, in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar, and he laid it upon my mouth, and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged. This is exactly the verse of concentration today. A live coal taken from the altar. Notice the altar is in the sanctuary of God. And so the solution to the issue of the unclean lips or unclean heart is really has its origin in the temple. In the temple of God, that's where God will solve the issue of sin. We have, remember that verse, this is the sum of all things that we have spoken. We have an high priest, Jesus Christ the righteous. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So the solution to the sin problem is Jesus Christ, and he will save us from our sin if we allow his life call to be put on our mouths. And I'll leave it to you to study the word of God to find out exactly what is this life call. But in my understanding, it is indeed the Holy Spirit of God, which touches our senses and our organs even, and moves us to do the will of God. And when all this has been done, in verse 8, we'll hear the voice of the Lord. Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then you will say, here am I, send me. With these words, I hope that you are blessed and that you will share this video as well. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Instagram, and Facebook, and may you share the gospel so Jesus Christ can come soon.